In this lecture, I want to tell you how do we serve web pages in a scalable way and how do we serve dynamic web pages in a scalable way. Dynamic web pages are pages that essentially adapt to the user. They're user-specific. They're not read-only pages that look the same to all users. So our goal is serving at scale. This means that in principle we can have as many users as we want. Dynamic web pages. And the reason I want to do this is that there are many decisions in the structure of Pyfarweb that make absolutely no sense if you think at Pyfarweb as something that serves you web pages from your own laptop while you sit developing code. There are very many things that you would have done in a different way if your main goal was to serving pages to a single user or maybe at most to a couple of users. The reasons and the motivations and the basic structure of the structure of a web server such as Pyfarweb can only be properly understood if you consider its ultimate goal, which is the one of enabling to serve things at scale to very, very many people to serve your content in such a way that it's tailored to each person. So let us look at the problem. So here is your web server sitting somewhere. And here is your first user. Okay, let me call it Ada. So Ada is now looking at your page, maybe trying to buy a ticket to go to the Bahamas or wherever, okay? So you're serving tickets for sale, for instance. So this is great. You have your first user. Now the problem is there may be another user, Bob, that soon joins. Okay? And so Bob also wants to browse tickets. He wants to go, I don't know, to Ireland. Okay? Now you have two users. And the point is this. When you get a request, actually, you serve a request and you're done with it. So you don't keep a history, you don't keep a history of conversation with Ada. Your requests to you look all like GET requests. For example, Ada will ask a page that is, for example, I don't know, like a search, in which she's gonna try to search for her flights. And he's also looking for flights. Okay. And after this, they want to browse, etc. But who? How do you know who is who? From your point of view on the server, you simply say, see that there is a request for search, a request for search again. How do you know if these come from the same person? How do you know if they come from two different people? How do you keep the history of conversation? Intuitively, it's easy for us in a humanized way to believe, you know, when you go to a party and you talk to a lot of people, okay, now I'm turned towards this person, they have a conversation. But the web server is having conversations with many users at the same time. How does he keep track of who's having a conversation with each interaction, and what is the history of every conversation, right? So this is a sort of fundamental problem. You want to be able to have people who log in, and so we want to associate identities to conversations so that in the end, you know, when Ada will purchase a ticket, for example, you know to whom to send it via email, you know which credit card has to be charged, and so on and so forth, right? So there is this basic problem. This problem didn't exist at the origins of the web. In the origins, the web was meant to be a document distribution system, okay, as conceived at CERN by Tim Berners-Lee. And so the main operation was to get a document, and there was no notion of having to keep track of conversations. So to keep track of our conversations, there was something added which plays a fundamental role in all our development to the web. And this something is called a cookie. I'm sure that you have heard the terminology. So let me have cookies as brown, which is an appropriate color. So when Ada talks to me for the first time, I simply get a GET request without anything. And what I do is that I reply to her with a web page, but I also include a cookie that I write simply in these parentheses, or maybe I should use round parentheses, not to confuse with tags. And so what is a cookie? Fundamentally, a cookie it can be many things, but for us in Pyfrweb, very often it will be simply a very long random string. B8, GH, F2, and whatever, right? So Ada gets her cookie, and when Bob requests her page the first time, his page the first time, he also gets a cookie, okay? Which is a C23, B1, and so on and so forth, okay? It's just another random long string. We will talk later about how to generate cookies and what are the rules for generating cookies in a safe way and all that. For the moment, imagine cookies as long random strings. But cookies in general are pieces of information that you can send to browsers who requested the web page. And the rule is that in any subsequent interaction, when there is a cookie, the fundamental rule of a cookie is that if Ada got a cookie from our site, she will include the cookie in any further request to our site. So somewhere we want to be able to associate the cookie to the conversation. In the conversation we'll have a lot of information. For example, Ada may have logged in, we may want to keep some shopping cart content, we may want to keep many other things. So somewhere we want to store a database table, and maybe let me use green for databases. We want to have a database table somewhere that has here the cookie, okay, and here some information, and this information is traditionally called session instead of conversation history. That's the name it's used, okay? So there is a big table that has entries, and it will have one entry for Ada's cookie, B8, GH, F2, and etc., and another entry for Bob's cookie, C2, 3, B, 1, etc., okay? And here you can put a lot of information. For example, suppose Ada has already logged in, then inside the database there will be written something like the user is called Ada, the email is ada@gmail.com, etc., etc. And for this user, maybe Bob hasn't bothered logging in, but maybe you have information about what he searched for, what pages he looked at in your site, because they want to keep context, maybe what is a shopping cart is. Okay, so let me draw a small shopping cart here. Okay, so the session is essentially the information that is user-specific that you want to keep associated with a conversation. And the cookie is the means by which, in a request, you distinguish one user from the other, right? When the user makes a request, the cookie is included, and the very first thing typically you need to do is take the user's request, look at the cookie, look up the cookie inside this table. This table is typically called the session table. Okay, the names vary according to the various web servers, but that's a common concept, okay? And so you have this table that needs to sit somewhere, okay? So you may wonder, you know, why cookies? You know, can't I use an IP address? After all, Ada will have an IP address to talk to me, no? And so maybe she has 1234567878. Maybe this is her IP address. The point is that IP addresses don't work because they don't actually refer to her as her laptop. Typically, nowadays on the web, there are things like the ISP router, okay? Or maybe, home router. You have a router at home, okay? The IP address as seen from the server is actually associated with the home router. And behind the home router, I draw them in very light gray or in gray, no? Behind the home router, there can be other people, okay? For example, Ada's roommates, okay? So from the point of view of the web server, many requests can come from the same IP address, but there can be multiple people behind that same IP address. Many companies even have a router that makes all the requests from their whole internal network come out of the same IP address. So you have only one IP address for maybe, 100 to 1,000 of people. That's actually fairly common. The other problem for which you cannot use IP addresses is that people move. Bob, for example, may be browsing here, then he closes the laptop, moves to the library of his town, reopens the laptop, and continues browsing from there. And when he connects to the other Wi-Fi point at the library, he gets another IP address. So that's why instead of using IP addresses, which would be the obvious, right? When you talk to another person, you normally think, oh, their address is what I'm talking to. That's true in the super short term, and in a network sense of where packets are routed. But the logical sense of where the request comes from is actually carried in the person's browser via the cookie that is set. Okay? So this is good. This tells us that we need a database and we need to put sessions in it at the very least. Now, what happens when you start serving to more and more people? Okay, so now there is Ada and Bob and they're all happy and they can get their own pages. And then now you start having a crowd of other visitors, which for you means it's really great because you typically want to have many people visiting your site, whatever, etc. So here you have a big crowd of people, okay? Now, this big crowd of people try all to talk to your server, and at some point, your server will be overwhelmed. However big a computer you buy, it has a limit to how many requests it can serve per second, and once you go over that limit, you need to do to have something bigger, okay? Imagine that you're designing one of these websites where people need to go quite often and maybe all at the same time. For example, a site in order to schedule people for vaccines, for instance, you cannot have a single computer doing that. Not only you cannot, but even if you could, sometimes it's not convenient because due to economies of scale in production and other factors, it's sometimes much easier to buy 10 cheap computers than to buy one that has the power of the 10 accumulated, right? This is some of the insight that Google was based on when it grew, right? That instead of buying very expensive hardware, it would be developed on commodity hardware, and reliability would be overlaid on top of that via software. So anyway, at some point, the single server is not going to be enough for you anymore. So what do you do? Well, you use multiple servers. Ah, this is great. And imagine that there is an easy way to route requests to each one of these servers. Typically, we won't have to bother with this task. It's not a super deep task. You just need to look at something like the IP address or the cookie or some other aspect of the request, and you need to essentially perhaps compute a hash and use a hash to route the request. But there are various ways of doing it, and it's typically done, by the way, by the cloud providers for us. That's why we don't want to bother so much with it. But now the issue is that you have multiple separate servers. So when you develop in Pi for Web, and in fact you have been using it even now, even though you may not realize it, Pi for Web has a database that sits in the local file system. It's in this databases directory, okay? Now we have the problem, where do we put this database here? Okay? Where do we put the database? Can we put it into the file system attached to here? So can each one of these web servers have their own database? And the answer is no. Okay? The problem is that when you make a request, you're not guaranteed to which one of these servers you're talking, generally. Maybe you are guaranteed in the short term, but certainly not the day after. So there is no way for you. Suppose I buy a ticket to the Bahamas, then I want to go, and look at the date of my ticket, which will sit in one of these databases. There is no way for you to know, to say, please, can I talk to the same server I was talking yesterday, right? So this doesn't work. There is also a more fundamental reason for why this doesn't work. So let me delete these small databases. Typically, the number of these servers varies dynamically according to load. Okay, you want to bring up new ones, and you want to delete them when nobody's using them. If you could, because you pay for them on the cloud. So it's not in your interest to keep them running all over the place. So, all over the time. So you need to put the database in some other place. So you have to have a database server. I draw, the database as if it was a sort of well, it looks like a trash can, I have to say, but it's meant to be a big hard drive, which is what they used to be, database servers once upon a time. Nowadays, they are more often made out of flash memory. So you have a single database server to which all of these hosts can open a connection and talk to. Okay, so this is again a network connection. Okay, this is a network connection. You talk to databases via a network connection. The database sits in a very powerful server, or not very powerful, depending on how much you want to pay. And the session table is one of the many tables that sit into this database. Okay, so that when you communicate with a front-end server, these are called, typically, their full name is front-end servers. When you talk to a front-end server, then the front-end server will talk to the database server via an internet connection that is, you know, in the cloud. So if I had to draw the cloud of your provider, for example, it can be this. Okay, so this is, if you will, in the cloud, and this is on Earth, I guess. Okay, so these connections are not visible from outside, but each front-end server can talk to the database via them. Okay, and this enables you to spin up and down front-end servers connecting to the database. So the database fundamentally has various roles that does for you. So roles of a database. One is, of course, storing the data. Okay. In a place accessible from all front end. Okay. You want to have a single place where to store the data. Another thing that is quite fundamental that a database gives you is consistency. So we will get more into detail about it when we talk about databases in detail. But the consistency means that you have one copy of the data, and the modifications to it are controlled in a way that makes sense, to put it in a very informal way. Imagine that there are two people that try to buy tickets, okay, to the same seat on the same airplane. So I try to buy seat 1A, you try to buy seat 1A. And these transactions may occur, I mean, my request and your request can occur at two of different of these front-end servers, okay? Maybe I'm talking to the first one, you're talking to the third one. And so we are both trying to modify seat 1A on that particular airplane to go from free to taken, okay? And we have to ensure that not both modifications can be carried through, okay? That one of my modifications would look like this. If the seat is free, I want to grab it and I want to mark it occupied by Luca. And your transactions will be, if the seat is free, I want to grab it and mark it occupied by Eleanor. Okay, only one of those can go through. And so the databases give you a way to take simultaneous requests from multiple places and execute them in some order in which you cannot guarantee that all requests are satisfied. You can only guarantee that the outcome is consistent. For instance, that you won't sell the same seat to two different people. This is fundamental. We will see it in detail when we talk about databases. But that's one, another incredibly great thing that databases give you. In fact, if I can wax lyrical a little bit, concurrency, or the ability to do multiple things at the same time, is an incredible capability of computing systems, but is very difficult to manage. It's very difficult to write software where multiple things can occur at once. It's very easy to make mistakes. And essentially, perhaps the biggest gift that databases give to web developers is the one of managing concurrency, managing concurrent access. You, as a web developer, you will have to basically mostly worry about what happens when you get one request and how to process that one request. You will not have to worry about what the other thousands or millions of people requests will be doing in the same time. The worry about how to process these millions or thousands of concurrent operations in a way that lets them not interfere one with the other, the burden of that will be carried by the database. Okay, so this is a major gift that databases give us in terms of the mental simplicity that we have to carry with us when we develop for the web. Okay, so these are the two roles that are fundamental: storing the data and caring about the consistency. You can also say concurrency, in fact. Concurrency. The third thing that that they give to you, even though we will not go very much into it in this class, is essentially data backups and also recovery and also availability. Okay? Databases have these ways in which you can replicate the data across multiple databases. You can put them in different data centers so that even if one of the data centers is hit by a meteorite, then you know the other ones survive and you don't lose your company's data, etc., etc. So databases are fundamental, essentially, to web development. And here I mean databases in a very broad sense, not only MySQL databases that we will be using, but also other databases which we will be using, such as, for example, blob stores. There is a great variety of databases, and we will be describing some of them later in the class. Okay? And so this brings us really to what we need out of the structure of our web server. We have many front-end servers. Okay, this is my front-end. We have databases in the back-end. So this is a database server, okay, and inside there will be the database. You know, here there are people, there are the users, multitudes of users, so they do requests, and their requests carry cookies. Often. So what do we have to do to make it all work? What do you need to do in order to serve a request? Okay? Serving a request generally works like this. It typically involves these various steps. Okay? So you need a database connection. You need to have somewhere this database connection so that you can talk to a database and look up the cookie. Okay? After this, you look up the session using the cookie. Okay? Once you look up the session, you can answer the question and check if the user is logged in. Okay? Because that's written as part of the session. So these are the three things you need to do pretty much at the beginning of every single request. You need to check that the database connection is established. You need to look up the session, check the user if is logged in. Only after you do these three things, then you can process the actual request. Okay, which may involve some additional checks and then, you know, the body of your work. For example, issuing additional queries to your database to see if the seat is available, looking which flights are available, and so on and so forth. So this set of tasks is extremely important. We will see that it is directly related to how the beginning of each snippet of code for answering a database request begins. Next lecture, I want to see, I want to show you how essentially you establish these steps 1, 2, and 3 before you go on to process the request. I want to show you how that is done in Python Web, and I also want to take the occasion to discuss the difference between Python Web, its predecessor Web2Py, and other web frameworks such as Bold.py, on which Python Web is based, because this will give us a good perspective on the design motivations really for Python Web.